come to talk to you about management contracts. Sheridan's has a long association with the law school. Those of you who are students on the Masters and have been in the Director's Cuts section of our website might have seen that Daniel Gee has done a number of sessions for us in the past, on mainly around sports. He did a session on broadcasting rights, a session on issues in sport and law, all of which are available on videos on the website. Chris was involved last year. He came and did a panel on esports. We really tried to demystify the whole idea of esports. So Chris, as well, has been involved with the law school for a number of years, doing different bits and pieces. So delighted he's come today to talk about management contracts. Sheridan's, maybe you'll talk a little bit about Sheridan's and the work and the sort of things they do, but a well-known solicitors down in there, just off Old Compton Street. Chris himself, I've decided to embarrass him because Chris was also a professional cricketer back in the day. And I'm obviously going to read out all his figures. I'm not going to read out all his figures. But Chris actually was one of the youngest players to play for Derbyshire, played against the West Indies. I think the youngest player to play at that point, is that right?
Yep.
16 years old, played professional cricket. So not only is he a lawyer now working for an excellent boutique entertainment law firm in the West End, but was a professional cricketer as well. So you can tell I'm very jealous. But without further ado, I'll pass you over to Chris, who's going to take you through this. In terms of things like questions, Chris said he's happy. If you've got a specific question as he's going through about something he mentions, put your hand up. He's happy to answer questions there. So you don't feel you've got to save them to the end if there's something that's really burning at the time. If it's really tangential, probably keep it to the end because it will spoil the flow. But if it's actually something around what's going on the slide itself or something specific, Chris is happy to answer it. But don't get too crazy. Okay? Without further ado then, thanks Chris, and over to you.
Thank you, Sky. Thank you for inviting me down to talk, and everyone, thank you for coming along. So, yeah, as Guy says, my name is Chris Padgett. I'm an associate in the sports and music group at Sheridan's. A little bit about Sheridan's, as Guy kind of alluded to, we're a boutique sports entertainment firm based in Soho, founded in the 50s or early 60s, predominantly as a music firm, and it's kind of from there that we've kind of grown and expanded across all of the entertainment sector. So unlike the majority of law firms whose kind of main cost and profit centres be corporate, property, or financial services, we still have all of those offerings, but our main cost and profit centre is the entertainment world. So in terms of what I want to kind of briefly touch on today, and as Guy said, I do want this to be interactive, so if you do have any questions, please do just kind of shout them out and I'll try and deal with them as we go along. There should be time, I think, at the end to cover off any specific points. But in terms of structure, a very short bit of background and introduction, which I've kind of already done. Then we'll briefly look at the role of a manager and how that's developing. I should say that my practice is, I suppose, based in entertainment generally. So I sit within the sports team, but actually I advise predominantly talent across the whole of the entertainment sector. So whether that be musicians, artists, songwriters, producers, through to Premier League footballers. We do a lot of work in the online space, a lot of vloggers and YouTubers, as well as Guy mentioned, esports is quite a burgeoning area for us. So I'm going to try and look at this relatively holistically across the whole of the entertainment space, using music as the kind of the core area because that's the most established really from a case law and perspective, but also try and give you some kind of anecdotes and some of the experiences that I've had across the different areas and how you'll actually see there's quite an overlap between the various different management and agency relationships across the entertainment space. So we'll look at the role of the manager, briefly look at some of the legal principles that underpin the relationship and how that relationship is regulated. And then, that's a strange little coming off the screen, then look at the management agreement itself and just pick out some of the kind of key clauses, some of the key, I suppose, commercial issues that you come across in practice, how you look to deal with those, and depending on obviously which side of the fence you're sitting, whether you're acting artist or management side. So we've kind of done that. That's me, associate in the Sports and Music Group. Sheridan's, again, as I said, boutique West End firm, and they're the kind of the key areas that we work across. So, as I say, music was the kind of the how the firm started, representing acts through from kind of Pink Floyd, The Who, Led Zeppelin, through to acts like McCartney, and more recently Sam Smith, Dizzy Rascal, Robbie Williams, and acts of that kind of nature. And I suppose we're very fortunate in the sense that we work with artists and creatives across the whole of the, firstly the whole of the entertainment space, but also we're quite privileged in the sense that we have some very high-hitting, well-renowned clients where you see, so you see the very best deals and you also see the very worst deals and you see everything in between. So we're quite fortunate, I suppose, in that respect. Obviously, standalone film and TV team as well, who work, again, predominantly talent side, but they also have a film financing arm. Sport, which is the team that I actually sit within. Computer games, we have the largest private practice computer games team in Europe, acting from clients such as Mojang, I suppose, is the kind of the best example of Mojang creates Minecraft, the game, and we started working with them when they were just two mates in one of their mother's back rooms, and then went all the way through and sold them to Microsoft for, I think, $4 billion about 2 years ago, so a bit of a success story for them, which we kind of hang on the coattails of. And then we also have a data, fashion, retail, and advertising and brands team. But what, as I also say, have a kind of corporate real estate, employment law and litigation teams, but again, all really focused within the entertainment world. So, the role of the manager. I get asked quite a lot what the difference is between a manager and an agent, and I think it's quite an interesting question, and I don't think there's necessarily a right or wrong answer in what or how you define them as, but for these purposes I've tried to come up with a short kind of differentiation between the two. As far as I see it, a personal manager is a person who helps develop and guides talent in relation to all creative, business, financial and professional matters in their career. And I think the creative element is the key differentiator between a manager, as I would define them, and an agent. And so, in my mind, an agent fulfills more of the role of a business manager, so a person who represents talent across the financial and contractual matters. To give you, I suppose, a bit of an example, a music manager would tend to fall into the management category because they will work not just with the artist in relation to how that artist goes about their commercial lives, but they will also work often quite in depth with the artist to help cultivate and develop the sound of that artist, the creative direction of that artist. And that's especially the case at the beginning of an artist's career. Interestingly, as artists develop through time, the role of the manager likewise develops. So your established act who has had numerous number ones or is already critically acclaimed, the role of the manager will be markedly different to an artist who's trying to break themselves and who the manager is trying to work with them to facilitate that. And I suppose the sports agent falls more within this business manager category as well. So it's a more linear relationship, one which is derived from, in truth, money and cash rather than fostering creativity. And when we're advising artists, I try and install in them, especially when artists are starting out, to think of themselves as a business, whether they actually have an incorporated business or whether they are doing everything independently and personally, but to think of themselves as a business. And for them, and when I'm trying to define what the role of a manager is for them, and when they ask me, it's really that they are the CEO of that company. If that artist is a company, then the manager is the CEO. They report directly into the artist and they're responsible for guiding that artist on their journey. But likewise, you have other third-party advisors that are involved within the central artist team, being the lawyer on the one hand and the accountant on the other. And the slight difference between the two is that, strictly speaking, while the manager is acting on behalf of the talent, there is also a vested interest in the success of that artist. And it's from that position that potential for undue influence comes in, the potential for conflicts of interest come in, and the potential for issues in and around restraint of trade. And so, and we'll come on to some of the cases shortly, but it's on that basis that it's now very much established practice that all individual artists will have their own independent lawyers and accountants. And while day to day I will be liaising with the manager in relation to all of the activities of an artist's life, or a YouTuber's life, or indeed a sportsman's life, my direct responsibility is always into the artist. I charge by the hour, whereas the manager will take a slice, usually, of the revenue that's generated. So it's important to have that kind of differentiation in mind. And the other thing I think to mention at this point in relation to the role of the manager is that in the modern landscape within the music model now, in terms of most artists when they're trying to break and get ahead, the self-releasing model is very much the way that the market's going. And with that brings a certain shift in emphasis for the manager, not so much now as the primary job to find and shop the artist around to get a label, to get a publisher on board. In fact, it's shifted and it's gone back to more of the model that it was like in the 60s, really, in truth, where the manager works almost in collaboration and in partnership with the artist. With that brings a shift in the emphasis, really, in terms of the role that they undertake. And now managers really are expected to be both labels, publishers, live agents, continue to do their management day-to-day duties, as well as all of the kind of the promotional marketing and PR stuff that would usually be farmed out to your label and to your publisher. But with that change in model also comes a change in emphasis, and we're beginning to see a shift in the way that especially new artists are working with managers, and it's becoming less of a kind of linear relationship and more in a partnership, more of a kind of a production style arrangement whereby managers are working with artists on specific projects and often having to invest a lot of their own money in trying to get the artist to where the artist wants to go. And that does blur the lines as to what you would traditionally expect to see in terms of where the manager fits in the kind of the bigger picture. We're kind of just developing on that. This is something that I plagiarised from the MMF and the Music Managers Forum, and I think it quite neatly encapsulates the different sorts of roles that a manager has to fulfil. They obviously represent the artist. They are the strategic thinker and plot and plan, as well as kind of being the leader, I suppose, and being out there shopping the artist around, being their CEO, being their head of marketing. They're also one of the key decision makers, obviously. Key skill for any manager's organisation, both organising the artist and talent, but also the general kind of plotting the structure as to how you're going to go about conquering the world, I suppose. And finally, is implementation. The one thing I think they've left off is that creativeness, though. The role of manager to help foster creativity, to help direct artists to become the sort of artist they want to be, rather than potentially being pulled in directions like you used to see. There's an old kind of adage that that's kind of very far left or off centre acts gradually become more and more centralised as they realise that that's the way that you make money. And the manager can play a certain extent a role within that, either keeping them far left, an alternative, or if the right direction is to go slightly more mainstream, then to do that. So regulating the relationship, I think broadly speaking, there are four ways in which the manager or agent talent relationship is governed. The first is by way of common law, so the kind of the law of the land, or kind of the law which is created by custom and precedent. The second is statute, and while there isn't a standalone live or entertainment specific agency statute, there are a wide variety of statutes which all have their kind of their importance and are all applicable to the sector. There's also, within certain strands of entertainment, of course, specific sector regulation. Predominantly within sport, and we'll very briefly touch on on some of those and what they look like. And finally, of course, is the contract itself. So I thought it'd be useful as a starting point when we're considering kind of common law and how that governs the relationship to look at exactly how common law defines what an agency is. And it's the fiduciary relationship which exists between two people, one of whom expressly or impliedly manifests assent, i.e. the artist, and the other that should act on his behalf so as to affect relations with third parties, i.e. the agent. And it's the fiduciary relationship which is the key underpinning factor that regulates the relationship. And that, in truth, is based solely on trust and confidence. So I'm not going to go too much into what a fiduciary relationship is. We could be here for quite a long time. But broadly speaking, it's a relationship that, of course, arises when one party acts on behalf of another party and the implied duties that come with that. And, of course, the point to make is that those fiduciary duties are not in any way connected to contract. They're completely standalone and come into effect as and when somebody steps into a fiduciary position. I've pulled out, as I see it anyway, some of the key fiduciary duties that managers or agents owe to their principals. It's a non-exhaustive list, there will be more, but broadly speaking, these are the key ones. So to act in accordance with authority, to obey instructions, to use due care and skill, a key one obviously, to avoid and or make full disclosures of conflicts of interests, to never make a secret profit, to keep talents properly separate, to keep correct accounts, and to carry out instructions with reasonable dispatch. And it's from these fiduciary duties and the fiduciary nature of the relationship that the key kind of seminal case law in this area has come from. And we'll briefly touch on four of the kind of the big cases as they are, but I think that the overriding point to make is that this is a relationship of trust and confidence. Which way you sell it, it is a relationship of trust and confidence. And you can have the best agreement in the world, you can have the worst agreement in the world. But at the end of the day, if the trust and confidence is lost, and the relationship, the artist doesn't trust in the manager, or the manager doesn't trust in the artist, then that relationship is doomed. So it doesn't matter whether you've got a 5-year term, the chances are that will end, irrespective of what any contract says. And it's kind of from that breaking down of trust and confidence that we have the kind of seminal cases in this area. So the first is the case of Joan Armour Trading and Stone. So Joan Armour Trading was an artist in the kind of late 60s, 70s and early 80s, a singer-songwriter. That is the picture of her. And Mr. Stone was her manager. So to give you a very short bit of background, Mr. Stone and Joan Armour Trading had entered into a management agreement in 1973, but in 1976, before she released her third studio album entitled Joan Armour Trading, they entered into a new agreement, and it's that agreement which was the basis of the dispute. In 1980, she released her most famous album, which is Me, Myself and I, which I think went to number one, I might be wrong about that. But it was during the release of that album that she became disillusioned with the services of Mr. Stone and the arrangements that were in place. And so she issued proceedings to try and set aside the contract because it was entered into with undue influence on behalf of Mr. Stone. Interestingly, this case has never been, it's not reported, there are no case reports on it, but it's still held out as one of the seminal cases, which was one of the first real cases which kind of set the parameters as to what the fiduciary nature of the relationship was. But what came out of the case was quite interesting. The first was that during evidence it became clear that the lawyer that was instructed didn't know who he was acting for. He believed he was acting for Mr. Stone, whereas Mr. Stone alleged that he was acting for both Joan Armour Trading and Mr. Stone. Mr. Stone was the one that instructed him, and Mr. Stone was the one that picked up his bill. But notwithstanding that, he testified to the court that actually it was a joint instruction. And that's an important point which we'll come on to. The second, and arguably the most important point, was that there were two particularly onerous provisions within the contract. The first was that while the manager took 20% of all gross income other than on live, he had the ability to take 25% on any product that was released during the period of his management. So any album, so album three and four, he was able to commission at 25% on both recording and publishing. But importantly, that right continued in perpetuity, indefinitely. So effectively, he was in a better position than both the publisher and arguably the record label at the time. And the other point that was particularly onerous was that he was entitled to 20% of gross revenue from touring. Now, that is now, you would never get away with taking gross revenue on touring, and he didn't in this instance either, purely because the cost of touring is so extortionate that to try and take gross receipts on gross ticket sales on gross merchandise would arguably put him in a far better position than the artist. Anyway, so proceedings were issued in 1980, and as I say, Mr. Stone alleged that the terms were fair and reasonable and that Joan Armatrading was fully aware of what she was signing up to, but the court didn't agree, and they found in favour of the artist. And the case is important for the reasons that are up on screen. Firstly, it confirmed that managers do have a fiduciary duty to artists. It also confirmed that the contract can be set aside for undue influence, but importantly, and especially in this case, it was voidable rather than void. So it was able to be terminated as at the point that she elected to terminate, and it was at that point that the contractual relationship ceased. So it's no longer was the runoff commission applicable, but she couldn't claim commission that she had paid previously. The lack of independent legal advice was a key aspect in this case, and it became used as a yardstick to measure what a reasonable management agreement looked like. On the back of this case, we began to see, and in fact still do within a lot of management and agency contracts, a clause that deals specifically with legal advice, and it runs along the lines of that the artist confirms that they've been advised to take legal advice, and they have either taken legal advice and or have waived their right to do so. Arguably, I don't think that goes far enough. Depending on the type of relationship and the type of transaction that you're entering into and the terms that you're entering into, that might not be enough to get you by, and we'll come on to that shortly. The next case, Elton John against James. So Dick James was a kind of music mogul in the 60s, 70s and 80s. And Elton John entered into a whole suite of contracts with Dick James at the age of 17. He was obviously underage. His mum actually entered into the contracts for him, and he wasn't, he received no independent legal advice, but he entered into, as I say, a management, a recording and a publishing contract. In 1972, and sorry, I should say that Bernie Taupin entered into the same contract with Elton John. In 1972, Elton John released his first kind of critically acclaimed album, which is the first, I think, of seven straight number one albums. And the majority of those albums were still under the agreements that he had with Dick James Music. But by about the fourth album, Elton John realised that he really wasn't earning as much money as he thought he should be from his publishing activities. And so he started looking into the reasons why that was. And it materialised that Dick James Music, who was his publisher, had a whole suite of sub-publishing companies under the umbrella of the Dick James Music Group, which were effectively top slicing commission. So if he was releasing, if there were record sales, or sorry, yeah, if there were record sales in Spain, there would be a Spanish sub-publisher that would take a higher than average sub-publishing fee for that as a percentage, and then the money that was coming through back into the UK was less than it should be, which then materially reduced the royalty pool that Elton John shared, which, and then the added negative part of it was that Dick James could then also commission on the publishing royalties that he received. So he was effectively double dipping, and that's the reference to double dipping there. So anyway, Elton sued, as did Bernie, and relying on the Armatrading case, and stated that they'd entered into the contract under undue influence, and as such, the agreements were being should be set aside, and they were also a restraint of trade. And the main principles that came out of this, and interestingly, Elton won on one area but lost on the other. So the two main strands of the proceedings were first that the publishing arrangements, the publishing agreement should be set aside on the grounds of undue influence, and he should be able to recover his copyrights. He ultimately failed on that, but he didn't fail on any other basis really, other than he delayed too long in issuing the proceedings. And the second point was that the companies in the Dick James Music Group had breached their fiduciary duty to Elton and to Burney, and entered into agreements that unfairly diminished their royalties. It was on that point that he was successful. And so this case, which was also fully reported, so it was the first real time that we had anything, or the legal sector within the entertainment space had something they could pin their hat on. It confirmed that there was a fiduciary relationship. It extended that fiduciary relationship to companies within the management group. It also reiterated the need for independent legal advice. It shone a very, very dim light on so-called double dipping. But interestingly and importantly, it also put the burden of proof on the manager to refute and show that there was no undue influence at the time that the contract was entered into. The next case, the Rooney case, is obviously from the sports world. And there he is. Should really be wearing an Everton shirt now, as I'm an Everton fan, but we'll let that one slide. So the facts of this case are slightly different, and I don't want to dwell too much on them, but at the age of 17, Rooney set up an image rights company called Stonygate. I don't know how much you know about football arrangements and image rights arrangements, but basically a footballer being an employee, depending on their commercial standing, can, in certain instances, be paid a proportion of their salary through their image rights company. And that has benefits for both the club, on the one hand, because it reduces the tax bill that the club has to pay, but equally, on the talent, on the footballer side, it reduces their tax liability. And that's the main reason for doing it, but also you then create an investment vehicle and a vehicle that can contract on behalf of footballers. Anyway, so that's what Rooney did at the age of 17, set up his image rights company, Stonygate, and immediately entered into an exclusive worldwide deal with Proactive Sports Management. Rooney, again, obviously a minor, didn't receive independent legal advice, and importantly, there was no early termination or break clause in the contract. Anyway, in September 2009, and on advice of lawyers, because Rooney wanted to switch, he terminated. Proactive accepted termination, but sued him for repudiatory breach of contract, which Rooney defended. And he defended on the basis that the agreement was a restraint of trade. Now, interestingly, this case is slightly differentiated from the other cases because this relates to restraint of trade rather than undue influence. And the comment from the judge at the time was that for any arrangement to be brought within the realms of being a restraint of trade, there had to be some exorbitance or special feature. And in this instance, he found that there was. Firstly, there was an unequal bargaining position. Proactive were an established sports management company. Wayne Rooney was a 17-year-old boy who, by the judge's admission and Rooney's admission, was not commercially savvy. The term of the agreement was particularly long. It was 8 years. And when you compared that to the potential length of his footballing career, it could have been up to half of that period. So on that basis, the agreement was sort of set aside. It was interesting because neither party particularly won. So the two matters at play were firstly that Stonygate, or rather, sorry, Proactive, were suing for both the post-term commission that they felt they were owed on contracts they entered into, but also the unpaid commission from the date that Rooney terminated the agreement. And the court held that they were entitled post-term commission, but only on the agreements that they had entered, that they had actually brought to the table rather than any that Rooney had procured himself. And secondly, that they were entitled to unpaid commission from the date at which he terminated, but interestingly, it was on a quantum merit basis, i.e. a payment for work done rather than a flat 20%. But anyway, the legal principles to take from it really are that the legal advice clause, which we touched on previously, are basically ineffective. And you cannot contract out of restraint of trade matters as they are part of public policy. And anyway, so the final case, and I will just rattle through this one, relates to music artist Seal. The facts of the matter are that Seal, before he was famous, signed a publishing agreement with Mr. Wardlow, who ran Beethoven Street Music. In 1990, he also signed a management agreement. That management agreement allowed him, again, to double commission on both his publishing royalties and then also from the management perspective. Anyway, after Seal's first two albums, and he started, well, he kind of cracked America, it was agreed that Seal would terminate the management agreement and would go off and sign with a US manager. And they entered into a new agreement in 1995, the settlement agreement, under which Mr. Wardlow and Beethoven Street Music agreed to return all of the copyrights to Seal, but in return would receive 25% of ongoing royalties in perpetuity. And that at first sounds particularly onerous, but if you are the publisher, you own those songs indefinitely. And so actually the publisher was in a worse position. The manager was in a slightly better position, but the publisher was in a worse position than they would have been. Anyway, Seal honoured this agreement in 2002, when he then just stopped paying royalties. And at that point, Mr. Wardlow issued proceedings, and Seal tried to defend them, stating that actually the both agreements, the settlement agreement and the initial management agreement and publishing agreements, should be set aside and voidable because of undue influence, and the matter went all the way to the Court of Appeal. But what the case is interesting for is that actually the manager couldn't refute or couldn't produce evidence to suggest that there wasn't undue influence, because of course he has the burden of proof. But it was irrelevant, because the settlement agreement that entered into created a new contractual relationship, one which he was independently advised on. And I suppose it kind of plays into the doctrine that the courts will try and uphold bargains that are freely entered into, even if that bargain is not a particularly good one. And Seal felt this one wasn't, but anyway, he was unsuccessful, so that continued. So that's the common law position. I'm going to just quickly whiz through statute. As I say, there's no standalone piece of statute that governs entertainment law, agency relationships, but broadly speaking, these two employment agency do. Don't worry, I'm not going to go through these at all. I can circulate the slides so you've got them, but these are basically key provisions from that. These two pieces of statute are aimed more at employees and also at employment agencies, so headhunters and recruitment agencies. But equally, there are parts of it that are equally applicable through into the entertainment space. But broadly speaking, as you might be able to see, I'm not sure how visible it is from the back, but a lot of those simply replicate the fiduciary relationship and the fiduciary duties. Other statutes to be aware of: Bribery Act, paying bribes, receiving bribes, bungs, more prevalent in football than they are in music. And obviously the Fraud Act as well, so misrepresentation would be applicable. Third potential area is sector-specific regulation. So again, I don't want to dwell too much on this, but if you are dealing with sports clients or sports agents, then there will be specific regulations that will govern that agency relationship. Broad takeaways are that you have to be a registered agent, unlike in music where anybody, any of you can be music managers, music agents, I can be. In sport, you have to be regulated and registered. Different sports take different views on that. Football, for example, takes a kind of good character test approach, whereas cricket, you actually have to sit an exam. And the other major takeaway is that there are, for the regulated activities, there is a prescribed limit on how long a contract can be. So pretty much across the board, it's a two-year term. The point to note there, especially within football, is that it is only for the regulated activity. And the regulated activity relates to transactions, and that is moving player A to club B. It doesn't involve their off-field elements, hence why proactive management were able to enter into an eight-year agreement without falling foul of the regulations. The current FA regs weren't in place then anyway, but the FIFA regs broadly mirrored that. And the fourth, and arguably the most important for these purposes, is the contract itself. So the management agreement, obviously, its primary purpose is to govern the day-to-day activities of the relationship. It sets out a whole host of provisions which we'll come on to, but broadly speaking, it's for the benefit of the manager. It's not for the benefit of the artist. And the reason for that is because it often deals with post-term, the post-term position. If you are a manager and you don't have a contract in place, you're going to be pretty hard pushed to try and claim any form of runoff commission. We'll come on to what runoff commission is. So because of the fact that it benefits the manager, it can become quite a tricky scenario and a tricky presentational thing for managers when they start working with new clients as to when they put the agreement in front of them. And broadly speaking, there are three schools of thought on this. The first is that it's business and you should sign a management agreement. If you want to work with me and I want to work with you, we should formalise that. That's all very well and good. The difficulty is when you're first starting out with a new artist who hasn't really got a proven track record yet, there's very little money coming through, if any. Your role is to try and cultivate and develop that artist and really break that artist so that they become commercially or critically successful. But what you're doing is you're covering off the worst case scenario. You're covering off a position whereby the relationship's broken down and there is no longer a management relationship between you and the artist. And that's quite a difficult thing to try and tackle first thing. If that's the first bit of contact really that you've got with your client or with your artist, that's a particularly difficult thing. And these are heavily negotiated contracts. They're not particularly, to be careful what I say, they're not particularly valuable from a legal perspective because you can't charge very much for all of them. But you know, if we charge a set fee, we probably come in at least five or six times over that and write the balance that time off, because there just is so much negotiation, there's so many elements of it. And they're all pretty personal elements because they're dealing with something that neither party really wants to think about, and part of your job as a private practice lawyer is to navigate those sensitivities. Anyway, so that's the first school of thought, is that you put it in front of them straight away. The second is that you just hold fire. You basically have a trial period where you work together, and there will come a trigger point at which the management agreements get put in front of the artist. They will usually be a record deal or a publishing deal, or some form of merchandising deal if it's in the self-releasing space. And the third, believe it or not, is that you never put an agreement in front of them. And I've got clients whose managers have never put an agreement in front of them. One of the biggest, probably even the top five UK agencies, do not have contracts, and they work on the good faith principle that if you don't want to work together, we won't work together, and we'll come to an amicable resolution at the time. It's a dangerous position and a dangerous stance to take, but it works for them. And each manager, it kind of fits with their personality as well. You can really kind of track, you can kind of pick which managers are going to be more aggressive and which ones aren't, and just from kind of the way that they go about their kind of daily lives. So what should a management agreement cover? Well, broadly speaking, all of these things, and I'm not intending to go through all of these. Rather, I want to kind of cherry pick some of the what I perceive to be the most important points, which are, as I see it, the parties, the services, the scope, the terms, so the period that the agreement lasts for. The commission, obviously, is often the most important, as well as accounting and banking. So turning to the first point, who the parties are, this may sound like a bit of a daft question, and surely it's obvious as to who is contracting, but actually you'd be surprised. So if you're acting on behalf of the talent, that talent may be contracting personally, they may be contracting through a personal services company, they may be contracting through a variety of personal services companies and in a personal capacity. And different companies that they have may well have different rights to the talent and to the talent's activities, and it's important from a management's perspective that they encompass all of those. For the manager, again, the talent will want to know whether they're signing directly with a manager or whether they're signing with that manager's company or the company that manager works for, and that can be a very important point, especially if your manager works within the umbrella of a much larger organisation. So the key considerations here are usually, if you're acting management side, is personal inducements from the artist. So if the artist is contracting through a company, you want to know that A, you have all of you have all of the rights that you need under the contract, and that you have, I suppose you can pierce the corporate veil to ensure that you are binding the artist to your management, and they can't go off and seek their own personal management. From an artist's perspective, if you're signing with a talent company or a management company, you want to make sure that you've got a key person's clause or key person's provision. Broadly speaking, this is a mechanism within the contract that ties you directly to a named individual. Big management companies are very reluctant to give you these because it puts a lot of power into the hands of the named agent or named manager. But from an artist, it's key because you are, that is the person you're signing with. You're not signing with, I can't think of a big management company now. You're not signing with, in the YouTuber space, Gleam. You're signing with a named person within that company. And so basically all the key person provision says is that if your key person leaves, you can leave. Or if your key person is unavailable for an extended period of time, normally either 30 straight days or 60 days in a year, then you can walk away from the contract. And another point to just consider is assignability. If when you enter into your management contract, whether you're acting on either side, talent or management side, you want to know that you've got the ability or that you're not hamstrung in any way to be able to rearrange your affairs, your commercial and corporate affairs. So how long will the contract last? Broadly speaking, there are two mechanisms for tying down the term. The first is a period of time, and the second is a product commitment. Different sectors of the entertainment space take different approaches to this. We've seen within sports that you pretty much can only have a two-year deal, whereas in music, give or take up to 5 years is just about acceptable. But the other way of doing it is to, as I say, tie it to a product commitment. So that might be one album plus an EP, or it might be two albums. And then what you do is you work with the artist during the creation, promotion, release, and then for a certain period after that. But importantly, your commission is then tied directly to those products. So if I'm the artist and I release two albums, my manager will just commission on those two albums. They won't commission potentially on other activities. It again does kind of come with the scope of the services which we'll come on to. And all of these, it's another point to make really, all of the points that I'm going to draw out here, they're all commercial points. None of these are legal in any sense. And so during any negotiation, you will give with one hand and you'll try and take with the other. So it's not set in stone that you go into something on a product commitment basis and that's where you want to sign. And it may be that you actually end up signing on a period of time because you've decided actually it's worth giving that, but we, and in return, I know that I've got X, Y, and Z because to me they were more important. So the other points to consider when you're talking about term are, if you're dealing with the manager who puts a contract in front of you straight away and you sign it, is try and get a trial period in there, because you haven't worked with this manager before, you won't necessarily know whether the relationship's going to work. You might not want to sign up to an extended 2, 3, 4, 5 year period with them. Trial periods can be a useful way of offsetting concerns of artists if you do have the manager that wants the contract in place from the start. The next is break clauses. And these are customary across all of the kind of pervasive across all of the entertainment contracts. Broadly speaking, within music at least, it will have it will be tied to a period of time under which something isn't happening. So in the music space, the usual position is that for a 12-month period, you haven't been subject to a record deal. It's the kind of standard position. You then have arguments as to exactly what constitutes a record deal. Is it a major record deal? Is it an indie record deal? Is it a self-releasing model? These are all points that are quite heavily negotiated. But break clauses are certainly something that, with the longer term agreements, I would never advise a client to sign without having one. And the second, which are becoming increasingly more prevalent, especially across sort of YouTuber vlogging management contracts, but also within music contracts, is the use of kind of key performance indicators. So it can be quite difficult to arrive at what those key performance indicators are. It's easier in things like YouTubers and vloggers because you can tie that to a certain amount of following or a certain amount of engagement. Within football, it could be tied to a and the amount of revenue that's generated in off-field activities. With music, arguably, you could now do it in terms of the amount of monthly listeners or the amount of streams that you generate from any product release. These are all things that managers will look to push back on because it provides the it weakens the security that they have. But again, from the artist's perspective, it's certainly stuff that you should be pushing for. So what services are provided? Well, as we kind of touched on, there are various factors that will determine this. The first is, what is the talent's predominant sector? So if you are a music artist, the chances are that your management agreement will be a relatively all-encompassing agreement that covers the whole of the entertainment space, whereas if you are a YouTuber, it may well be that your management contract is tied purely to commercial activities in and around your online persona, but you're able to bring on board other agencies or other managers to manage different parts of your career. Likewise, what's the basis of the relationship? If you are a personal manager, the chances are that your management will be kind of all-encompassing, will be across each and every sector of the entertainment space, whereas if you are simply a business manager, it may well be that there are certain parts or certain activities which are excluded. A bit of a facetious example might be Gordon Ramsay, who has a very established restaurant chain, but at the same time is a TV and kind of entertainment talent in his own right. It may well be that his deal looks to expressly exclude services in and around his restaurants, but so that one person, that agent, will work with him in relation to all of his TV work. And the last point, I suppose, is, what are the manager's expertise? Certain managers, just like in any walk of life, will be very open and transparent and say, do you know what, I'm more than happy for you to go and get a literary agent, I'm more than happy for you to go and get a modelling agent or an acting agent, because they're not my bag. You will then have, and we'll come on to it, but discussions in and around what that manager can commission on if there are certain activities which are excluded. But that should also be a question that an artist asks at the start, or any talent asks at the start, is exactly what are you proposing to do for me and across which of the sectors. So in terms of the services themselves, I've kind of touched on the first point, whether the relationship covers the whole of the entertainment world or not. If it doesn't, then the manager, the kind of the headline manager, will still want an element of control over the artist, control over the choice of third-party agents that they use, only because they see themselves, as I alluded to earlier, as the CEO, as the person that's in charge, and they kind of want to be, when they're strategizing and coming up with commercial plans in and around a certain artist or a certain creative talent, they want to know that another agent in another territory in another sector isn't going to do something that cuts across that. Arguments will often take place as to whether a relationship is exclusive or not. This is predominantly sector driven. So within music, you would expect the arrangement to be an exclusive one just by virtue of that relationship. Whereas in the YouTuber space, for example, it's far more prevalent to have a non-exclusive arrangement. Again, because that relationship is more akin to an agent's relationship rather than a management relationship, you may well have a number of non-exclusive deals with a variety of agencies to bring in different types of branding deals. But again, these are points which are often quite heavily negotiated. Finally, are there any excluded talent activities? Well, we've kind of covered that. And finally, and this is perhaps a slightly bizarre one, but how detailed is the management agreement itself? There are kind of two schools of thought within lawyers. One is broad brush, keep it vague, capture as many rights as you can without being too specific. The other is incredibly detailed listing of what services are provided. The risk with the latter is, of course, that you miss something, in which case you're kind of stuffed. I tend to fall in the middle somewhere, so normally keep it vague and then list on a non-exhaustive list of kind of the high-level key areas that you would expect the manager, or the sort of services you'd expect the manager to provide. But again, kind of different lawyers have different approaches on that. So I suppose the big one, what do managers get paid and how do they get paid? broadly speaking, there's two ways that managers get paid. The first is on a commission basis, that is the standard. And the standard position is between 5 and 20%. But equally, you will find managers, especially with the more established artists and the more established talents, will take a fee. So one of our biggest music clients, who is probably the most famous living musician, has a very good manager and a very well-renowned manager who is paid on a fee basis rather than on a commission basis. And that is A, because of the commercial leverage and the commercial power that the artist has, but also from a management perspective, it's not a small amount of money that they're taking as a fee. And so they probably look at it and go, it's not the worst thing in the world to be paid significant six-figure sums over any 1 year, notwithstanding that I know the artist is getting a hell of a lot more than that. So again, it's one of those things that comes with bargaining position. Likewise, I recently concluded a management deal for two YouTubers, and we managed to get the commission rate right down to, I think it was 12.5%. But having looked over their previous deal, that had gone from the first deal they signed was 20, the second deal they signed was 17, and as they become more successful, the more leverage they have, but also the more that the manager is probably going to be willing to cut his or her rate, given that the slice of that pie, albeit smaller, the pie itself is a hell of a lot bigger. So typical range, kind of touched on that. There are sector conventions. So football, you would tend to see on-field rates being anywhere from between 5 and 10% of on-field gross income, whereas for commercial work, it's probably nearer the 20% mark. Likewise, in film, the standard going rate is normally about 15%. YouTuber standard rate is normally about 20%. Modelling is a bit of a law unto itself, and modelling agents tend to take commission on, strangely, both sides of the deal. That's changed now, there's legislation which governs that. But there, broadly speaking, their equivalent commission rate comes in around about 34%, albeit that it's not all paid by the model themselves. I think book agents take around about 15% as well. So there's a it's in and around that amount, but again, it's very much, it's kind of one of the key commercial negotiating points. So how is commission calculated? Well, broadly speaking, it's on gross income, so it's gross income from any deal minus certain deductible costs, and I'll come on to those costs. So if I enter into an endorsement deal with Nike and I get paid 100 grand, my manager will usually take 20% of that, so 20 grand. There are certain elements which will be on net though, touched on it in the Armour Trading case. Live work and touring work is always, or should always be, on a net basis. Some managers may try and take on gross, a 5% gross, for example, might be acceptable, depending on the artist, but that's where you really need to work with the accountants to make sure that the level of touring income is such that you can agree to a 5% mark. You will also often have arguments in and around exactly what that live commission is calculated on. So is it calculated on a territory by territory basis, or is it calculated on a tour by tour basis? And they don't sound much, but they can equate to basically being paid nothing or being paid an awful lot. Managers will always try and push for a territory by territory basis. So if I'm an artist and I'm touring in the UK, I want that to be a standalone tour. When I go to Germany, I want that to be a standalone tour. The risk of that to the artist is that, especially when you consider North America, there may be certain territories where the artist is very much established, in which case that's going to be a very profitable tour. But there may be other sectors where they're not established and they see it as a loss leader, they're trying to break the artist in that territory. If you are accounting to your manager on a territory by territory basis, you may pay them, you may have 100 grand's worth of profit on a UK tour, so you pay them 20%. But in the US, you might be 200 grand unrecouped and in the hole, in which case you as the artist haven't made much money at all, if any, you're in a hole, whereas the manager has come out and he is 20 grand up. Now, the manager's position is, well, that's the luck of the draw. We're going into this with our eyes open. I've had to work a lot harder in the territories where we're trying to break you as compared to the territories where we've already broken you. So you can see it from both sides. There are arguments from both sides. Again, it's a commercial leverage position. Which party holds the cards will often be the party that comes out on top. And the perversity of it is, of course, as private practice lawyers, we sit on both sides of the deal. So we will, in any one day, it's not uncommon that I'll be acting for a manager in a management deal and an artist in a completely separate deal. And you jump from one call, or you wear one hat, and then you have to quickly take that hat off, put the other one on, and start arguing against what you've just been making 5 minutes beforehand. So you have to keep your wits about you as to exactly which hat you're wearing. But the other point that I just wanted to raise is the kind of new business models point. I mentioned earlier on in the talk that, especially with new artists and trying to break new artists, the role of the manager's changed quite considerably, is at least changing. And so these new business models are coming about, and the best way that I can try and describe them is akin to a production deal. So where the manager and the artist agree that they're going to do, let's say, an EP, and the manager may be the party that's responsible for financing that, but in which case he may well take the rights into that EP with a view to securing in terms of securing security, and then try and upsell that product up into a label, up into a publisher, for which he then gets recompensed. That's a difficult argument to run. From my perspective, I'm predominantly artist side, but you can see merit in it, in the sense that you are taking investment, and that investment will usually not come with any form of interest, and in truth is being provided to you when you probably couldn't go and get it from any normal financial institution. So again, there are arguments on both sides. It's something to watch, and I think it's something that will continue to develop over the next couple of years. So what is and what isn't commissionable? This is obviously a key area. The main point is that you only commission on your represented activities. That's the kind of starting point if you are an artist. It usually ends up being broader than that, so it's not just the activities that you, as the manager, represent the artist on, but it's slightly wider than that. So if you have an exclusive deal, you will commission on absolutely everything that comes through the door for that artist, irrespective of whether you are the party that brokered that deal. There are obviously room for negotiating that. But the main points to kind of take home, I suppose, are that the agreements relate to both agreements that are entered into during the term, but also ones that are substantially negotiated during the term but entered into in a short period thereafter. So to give an example, if I am, again, back to the Nike contract, if I am negotiating a deal with Nike and then I get fired, and 2 weeks later the artist, the talent goes and signs with Nike, if my contract is correctly drafted, I should still commission on that because I have procured that work. The definition of substantially negotiated then becomes substantially negotiated in and of itself, and so does the period during which any substantially negotiated contract can be entered into. And finally, and probably one of the biggest ones, is runoff commission, or so-called kind of sunset clauses. So this relates to obviously the amount that the manager can continue to earn after the relationship has ceased. If there isn't an agreement in place, your starting position is you're not entitled to runoff commission, and hence why the manager wants the contract in place. So broadly speaking, runoff commission is broken down into two defined categories. One is at full rate and one is at half rate. The important thing to note is that commission is limited or is tied exclusively to the contracts or the products that were released during the period that they represented the artist. So it's not you finish tomorrow and you continue to earn on everything they do from tomorrow. It's tied to the product commitment. Again, different industries have different approaches. The starting point within music is 10 years, 5 and 5. 5 years at full rate, 5 years at half rate. Again, you would tend to see those sort of arrangements with an established manager and an unestablished artist. And then you can get those right down to, I did a deal last year which had one at full rate, one at half rate. So it really is one of the key kind of commercial points that are discussed, but also is the one that is most heavily, I suppose, even probably more so than the commission rate itself, predicated on the bargaining position of both the parties. And the last point that I wanted to touch on was really accounting and banking. It sounds pretty dry, but it's absolutely fundamental. Questions as who collects the money. When you are an emerging artist or a new artist, chances are that you don't really have much to rub together. You certainly won't have enough to engage an accountant to collect all of your income and account through to your manager. In that instance, you will often see the manager acting as the bank and collecting all of the income. It's a dangerous position to take, especially if you're an artist, because somebody else is collecting your money, and the bottom line is whoever holds the purse strings holds the control. I'm currently embroiled in a dispute with a YouTuber, which comes down to this very point. The manager collected the money and has failed to account through to around the tune of, well, I probably shouldn't say actually, it's a significant amount of money. And you know, they know that they need to pay it to us, they've admitted they need to pay it to us, but until they pay it to us, we will bend over backwards. So they're using it as a leveraging tool against us, and we're telling them we're using the threat of legal proceedings as a leverage against them. They don't want their name dragged through the dirt. Likewise, we really want our money. So you kind of come to a bit of a stalemate. So what usually then happens is that you will try and build into the contract, if it's with a new artist at least, that the manager will act as the bank to start with, will collect the money in a separate designated account for the artist, and all of the monies in that account are held on trust for that artist. And then at a point at which, to be mutually agreed, there's enough money coming through, the artist will then appoint their own accountant. Again, it's a costly process for an artist, especially if they're not earning big money, because accountancy fees can obviously be quite high, and it's not just they're doing their tax returns at the end of the year, they are actively managing all of those accounts and collecting royalties, paying out commissions. Accounting, when does it take place? Usually they will take place if you're acting for the manager, you want to be paid on a monthly basis, but equally if there are really big sums of money coming in. So if your artist just signs with a record label, gets a 200 grand advance, you will often try over a certain threshold to be paid within 7 days. Again, it's fairly customary, it's fairly industry standard, but expenses can be quite a big one. So to what extent can a manager incur expenses on behalf of a talent? How can these be incurred? You will usually see provisions in an agreement which provide that there can only be, there's a threshold on how much can be incurred without getting prior consent, and that's either a one-off amount or an amount cumulatively over a month or weekly period. They should only ever be repaid out of commissionable income. So if you're acting on the artist side, they should only be repaid from commissionable income. If you're acting on the manager side, you will try and just have those repaid to you as a debt. The risk, of course, for both parties is when the relationship ends, if there are still outstanding amounts owed, if it's owed as a debt, then the artist has to stump up the cash to repay the manager. But likewise, the risk of the manager, if it's from commissionable income, they can't claim that back until the artist earns significant amounts of money to be able to repay. And what they repaid out of, what we've already said that. And the final point to note is obviously rights of audit. Whoever collects the money will usually want the ability to look over the accounts to check the veracity of the accounting. And more often than not, especially with more established clients, that would be the manager wanting to look over the accounts of the artist. So that is pretty much all I had in terms of kind of rounding up comments. I suppose the kind of headline takeaways are that the way that these relationships are managed are pretty disparate, the disparate regulatory and legal framework. The role of the manager and the agent is obviously pretty sector specific. You can't really categorise. But at the same time, there are kind of pervasive elements which are across all of the sectors. And the last but not least is that all successful arrangements are based on trust and confidence. And it's a kind of point that I suppose I've hammered home a little bit, but it really doesn't matter what the contract says, because in truth, the management contract is negotiated, heavily negotiated, people fall out over it for a short period, they then make up, they sign it, and then it goes and sits in a drawer. And it only ever comes out at the point there's a dispute, and the hope is that it never comes out. And actually, if you look on the balance of probability, it doesn't get pulled out to that draw. There are very few cases on the whole which end acrimoniously. It normally becomes quite self-evident whether that relationship's working and whether it should continue. So that's all I had. Maybe an interactive session, and I've just rattled on for the best part of an hour, so apologies for that. If you've got any questions, please do say. If you don't want to ask them now and you'd rather speak to me afterwards, then I can hang around. Likewise, you've got my contact details there, so I'd be more than happy to pick anything up.
In examples where there's no agreement in place between the manager and their client, how is all this regulated? Because they've still got to agree, say, on commission terms. At least. So there must be, can you think of examples of how that's actually been administered?
I think the first thing to say is that the chances are that there's already been some form of conduct in place that has, during that relationship, there will have already been some accounting. Very few instances will you have a relationship that runs and there's been no accounting on either side. So what would you usually tend to see is, especially if you're one of the managers that either falls into the, we'll wait until a major occasion and then we'll set a management agreement up, or you never have a formal management agreement, you will still usually have some form of headline terms, whether it be over email, in a letter, something that sets out what that position is. But it is a significant risk. It's really a risk in the post-term position. In terms of what happens during the term of a management agreement, it's pretty self-evident because it happens on a day-to-day basis. Where it becomes more tricky is where you say that there is an agreement in place, albeit it's a oral agreement evidenced in writing. That's where it becomes a little bit messy, and that's where, unfortunately, lawyers get involved and then try and reach a kind of settlement, a negotiated settlement position. But again, it's a risk thing. We worked an act that I've worked on when I first started at Sheridan's, went through like five managers before they signed with a big US management company. And as soon as they signed with that big US management company, they all came out the woodwork because they were then deemed to have kind of made it. And there is always that risk. There's always that kind of skeleton, I suppose, in the closet. But when you're acting on the manager side, our advice is always get the headline terms down, get them in an email, get them sent across, try and get some form of agreement back that they agree to that position. But again, that's a tricky position to run for post-term. Chances are you're very unlikely to get post-term commission, unless of course both parties are very reasonable. And we had a settlement 2 years ago where there was no agreement in place, but it was agreed actually the artist held their hand up and said, yeah, fair cop, you did a huge amount for me, I think it's only right that you get paid a certain amount. We then argued over what that amount was and how long that amount continued, but it really comes down to the appetite of the parties.
In terms of, I've got a question about restricted covenants. So, say competitors trying to get a hold of, say, an artist or a footballer, for example, are those quite common in terms in agreement, management agreement?
Yes and no. I think more so in the kind of footballing world. But you tie it the risk is that if they're going to move. Then all you try and do is protect your position, and you try and protect it in whatever way you can, and that will often be a bit of bravado from lawyers. It may be in the footballing instance. It may be there are Rule K arbitrations. There's a private kind of forum for hearing those disputes. Dan, who's at the back of the room, is one of the partners in the team. How many Rule K's do you reckon you do a year? Eight? Yeah. And they are almost always agent to player and dispute in that respect. is much harder in the music sense because there is no private forum where these disputes can be heard, and that's a kind of barrier to not a it's kind of a self-regulating aspect of it, because very few people want their dirty laundry dragged through the courts, and actually very few people can afford to have their dirty laundry dragged through the courts. Hence why you almost certainly always end up with a form of negotiated settlement. But coming back to your specific question, do you have restrictive covenants? Not really. It depends on the nature of the relationship. If it's an individual relationship, it's very hard to have restrictive covenants in there. The restrictive covenant is by virtue of whether the relationship is exclusive or not, and the period of time under which you agree to be contracted to and represented by a certain person. But at the same time, the point stands, doesn't it? I think that if that player's going to leave, they're going to leave. All it then gives you as an agent, or manager, is another claim or potential claim. It just strengthens your position that you can say you've breached the term of the agreement, you've gone off and signed with another agency, and by the way, you should have done this, and this, and these are all warranties that you gave us during the term of the contract. So it's a positioning thing, it's a protectionary thing, and unfortunately it's one of the harsh realities of being a private practice lawyer is that you are a bit of a doom mongerer. You're always trying to cover off the worst case scenario. Of course the beauty is that you work with successful clients and you kind of reap the rewards of doing that, but at the same time there is unfortunately that you are brought in to ensure that everything is as watertight as it possibly can be, and that often means that if things are going south, what rights do you have? Anything else?
About halfway through your presentation, you had a summary of what you would expect to find in a management agreement. You don't mind looking back to the sort of three columns. I was wondering if that's essentially a model for what you'd look for in, say, in any music-related agreement as a basic sort of structure.
In any music-related agreement?
Yeah. So yeah, that could be equally for publishing or for a record deal.
The key difference, the key point in a publishing or recording deal is the rights position. So who owns the rights and how long they own them for. This is obviously not dealing with this. This is a straight services style arrangement. But broadly speaking, yeah, parties, period, services to a certain extent, depending on, usually it would be the opposite. So it would be the services that are expected of the artist to a record label or to a publisher. Talent responsibility is kind of that point. Third party agents wouldn't be applicable. That's something that's solely related to management deals. Territory, yes, very much so. Key person clauses, that's an interesting one. Key person clauses are something that should be in every single recording and publishing agreement, and they're not in any single publishing or recording agreement. And the reason being that when an artist signs to a label or signs to a publisher, they're signing to an A&R manager who really backs what they're doing, because that A&R manager is the person that stuck their neck on the line for that artist and said, I don't know, if the advance is 200 grand and they're going to spend five times that on trying to get a record out, it's the A&R manager's neck that's on the line, so he's the one that's championing that in the A&R meetings. He's the one that's trying to fight to make sure they get the best slots on radio, the best marketing spend, the best guys and girls in different territories to work the records. If that person leaves, you often buggered, especially if you've got a really big advance behind you. And I, one of the first clients I took on at Sheridan's, had exactly that. He signed He signed off YouTube, off the back of YouTube. He signed to Interscope in the US, to Jimmy Iovine, who's now at Beats. And he was his direct A&R guy. He signed him directly. He flew him over. He loved him so much, he flew him over. He played a Christmas party for Interscope. It was massive. And the deal he did was amazing. It was eye-watering. Jimmy Iovine left 9 months later, set up, and went to Apple. All went very quiet before he went to Apple. And lo and behold, this artist's very good album still sat on the stocks because there's nobody championing it. They're so far in the hole that they look at it and they go, we don't know whether it's going to sell or not, but we do know that we're already X hundred thousand, X million at the wrong end. So really, personally, you should always try and get key person royalties. You're never going to get it because, again, the labels and publishers will look at that and go, there's far too much power tied up in the hands of one A&R manager. And, where you can sometimes get it is when you have imprint labels or imprint publishers, which are becoming increasingly more prevalent. And more prevalent across what imprint style companies across all of the entertainment space, in truth, especially as there are certain talent which are really, they're so big that they can basically do what they want. They want to have their own label, they want to have their own publishers, they want to have their own management companies, they want to have their own production companies if they're YouTubers. But they don't want the hassle of doing that, so they will often, when they do a deal, try and have some imprint arrangement. Commission, well, royalties, yeah, they would be across all publishing and recording contracts. So would expenses, accounting. Banking wouldn't happen, but the accounting provisions would, as would audit. Audit is one of the key provisions, especially in any record or publishing deal. Basically, rough rule of thumb, you go platinum, you audit. Because the chances are there is money flying around the system. Not necessarily by any fault of the record label, but if you think how convoluted accounting systems are across the whole of the globe, it's hardly surprising that money gets lost in the system. And that so-called black box income is when you become a really big artist, you try and get a share of that black box income, which is effectively money that they have sat there, but they can't attribute who it belongs to. Only in very few cases would you ever get a share of that. I think on one deal that I've been involved in, we've got black box, which is, even if you get 0.5% of black box income, that's still a huge amount of money because there's a lot just flying around. Warranties, yes, they'd be in there. Authorities, that's authority to sign contracts. That wouldn't be in an agreement. Termination, obviously, yes. Leaving member provisions, you would actually have that in relation to record and publishing deals. So if you're part of a band, you'll often have that built in as to how those mechanisms are governed. Notices, assignment law, and jurisdiction, again, they would be across those as well. So, yeah. But there are nuances. The headline points, yes, but what those points actually cover will be quite drastically different to what they'd be in a management agreement.
Okay, thank you.
So I've worked in classical music management agencies, and the agreements that they have in place don't have half the stuff you've talked about. What would you suggest the agency or the artist does with these contracts which don't mean anything?
Well, it doesn't necessarily, just because they don't have these things in it doesn't mean that they're not valuable contracts. It just, it's the kind of the perversity of contracts, in truth, is that you try and cover off every eventuality, whereas in actual fact, what's the key thing here for an artist, or what's the key thing here for a manager, and that is commission. How long do they get paid, or what do they get paid, and how long do they get paid? The key things for the artist are probably going to be what services they provide and how long were they tied down to doing it. So it really depends on what those contracts say and what they provide. If they don't provide robust and watertight provisions in relation to commission and how long they can commission for, and on what products, then that's a concern. But if it relates to indemnities, well, you know, I might be the only lawyer out there that's willing to stand up on a stage and say indemnities aren't that important in entertainment contracts on a talent basis, because the truth of the position is you're just going to sue them anyway. It doesn't prohibit your ability to sue an artist or to sue a manager. What it obviously prohibits you from doing, or rather, what it means you have to do, is you have to go through the standard issues of remoteness causation in the calculation of those damages. You don't have a kind of blanket that you can rely on. But indemnities are one of the things that I was amazed at when I started doing entertainment work, is just how wide ranging they are. If you look at, my wife's a corporate real estate lawyer, if you look at the indemnities that they have, they're 12 pages long, they have so many caveats, so many, you know, so many different permutations. In entertainment contracts, they're that big. And it's just wide blanket ranging, and it's amazing. But so there may be parts that at first sight think, God, they're really important that you have, but they might not be that important. So I'm kind of fudging the answer, the answer. But you need to look at, in any contract and treaty, you need to look at what are the key leverage points. What are the bits that you need to cover off, and the rest you end up just thrashing out if you come to a dispute. So I just have a look through them and see what they provide and what they don't. And also there'll be a certain amount of industry trends potentially as to why those contracts are the way that they are. Because actually if a few big players start doing something one way, then everybody else will fall into line, because otherwise everybody's going to go to the competitor.
That's a really interesting point. So quite a famous academic American lawyer, who I really like, called Stuart McCauley. Those of you doing the entertainment law class, I've mentioned a few times about relational contract theory and these sort of things. And he makes a really good thing, sort of ties into what you were talking about there, where he says there's a paper deal and there's a real deal. And it's sort of almost there's like a text between the lines almost.
Yeah.
Sometimes you have something which is like your end game theory.
Yeah.
It's in the drawer that you need it if it all goes pear-shaped.
Yeah.
But generally speaking, it's quite organic, because generally it's about a relationship. And you want to keep each other sweet, and you want it to carry on.
Yeah.
So you don't really go to the strict terms of the contract. You use that as a sort of framework with which you organise the whole relationship that exists. And all it is really a badge of the relationship
that
exists in many
ways. It's one of the hardest, it's one of the hardest parts of being a private practice rather than an in-house lawyer, is that balancing act. Because clients come to you, especially established clients, may have their own in-house legal team, but for the really big ticket stuff, they'll come to you. And they come to you because they're effectively paying, cynically they're paying for an insurance policy. If it goes wrong, they've got someone to sue. They're not suing their own in-house team. But the risk with that is that your job is to be a lawyer, is to make sure that a contract is as watertight and as robust as it possibly can be. But at the same time, you don't want to be that person that stands in the way of the deal. And trying to get that balance between commerciality and legal protection is I don't know how many of you are lawyers or want to be lawyers, but that is the hardest, that is, I would suggest, the hardest part of being a private practice lawyer. I closed a deal, same guy, I closed a deal earlier this year, quite a high profile branding deal between an elite sportsman and an elite brand. But the sportsman, I was brand side, the sportsman had far greater leverage commercially than we did. You know, he can go and do a deal with anybody, pretty much. But we need him, and we're willing to put quite a lot of money up front, a lot of money in activating the relationship to make sure that we get him. So from a legal perspective, once you thrash the commercial terms out and they're in a position, then there's still a lot of back-end legal work to do, and especially in and around endorsement-style deals where, you know, look in the press over the last 5 years, how many high-profile endorsement deals have been rescinded because of morality-style clauses. And all of those type of legal protections you need to have in place. But at the same time, the brands just want to get the deal done. I wasn't dealing with a lawyer, I was dealing with their head of commercial, and he just wanted to go to the board and say, we've got this deal in position. My role was to try and make sure it was as legally robust and watertight as possible, while still being alive to the kind of the commercial realities of what was happening on the ground. And at the same time, you constantly shit yourself that something comes up. 5 years' time, something goes wrong, and they go, this contract isn't any good. Because the problem is, you're looking at it then from a purely legal textbook perspective, you're not looking at the wider context of how that deal fell within the kind of commercial landscape itself. And that's the truth, that's the thing that keeps you awake at night. It's not did he get the best royalty rate, it's did we strike the best bargain on the commercial bits, the legal bits, the bits that you're actually brought in to do.
Yeah, thought that was tremendous. I thought it was really authoritative, incisive. I really like the way you went through the idea of, you know, the role and scope and the what the manager actually does, then gave us that legal sort of landscape and then went through the terms themselves. You made the point that, you know, you'd rattle through it all, but you said at the beginning, you know, you could take questions on the way. I think it was a mark of how well constructed your presentation was and how you covered it, that there weren't any questions really, and they were just dredging them up at the end to try and trick you or pull them over on you. I had a few questions, but I'll leave them for now. I thought some nice questions there. But I'd just like to say thank you very much indeed, Chris, for coming. I'm sure everyone would like to thank you. It's been a great talk, really really useful, I think. And if we can have the slides to the blackboard,
our
learning environment, that'd be fantastic.
Yeah, of course.
That was great. So I'm sure we'd like to thank Chris for all his efforts.
Cheers, thanks, Matt. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.